plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. I see the wickedness, says Lord, perpetrated by the Babylonians. Pride and arrogance and their own strength is their God. God himself, our God himself, would raise the Babylonians up to defeat God's own people. Now this confused the prophet even more. Why would God raise up somebody to defeat his own people? Well, then the prophet Habakkuk got a little more daring. He had the very audacity to ask the Lord why he, the Lord, was so silent while wicked men prospered and righteous men were swallowed up by them. Sounds like something we ask today. So this brings us to today's lesson. In verse 1, the prophet says, I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower, and I will watch to see what he will say unto me and what I shall answer in when I am reproved. The prophet Habakkuk wore his righteousness around him like a cloak, and he requested answers to his questions that he posed to God in chapter 1. He likened himself to a watchman. Well, in the prophet's day, the cities were fortified with strong walls, and the watchman sat on the ramparts and he could see into the horizon. He could see the enemies approaching. He could see visitors approaching. But, you know, this was a job that required patience because it was a long, tedious job and usually a lonely job. So the prophet is using this analogy to show that he is a patient person, he says. But he uses this because he is, and in another way, he uses this because he is a watchman over God's people. More like, say, the pastor is over a congregation. He waited for God to answer his complaint. You know, we wait, but what are we doing while we're waiting? Are we just sitting or are we praying about the situation? The prophet wanted to be in a best position to receive God's answer. And we look at this word reprove. Reprove means to correct, but in a more gentler manner. And that is God's character. God is gentle when he reproves us. He doesn't yell, scream, and yell at us the way we yell, scream, and sometimes yell at him. In verses 2 and 3, God gives Habakkuk specific, detailed instructions. He says, this is my answer. And I'm charging you, Habakkuk, to write it plain in the best simple language that you can do. Write it plain and put it on tablets. But not only that, I want you to use the swiftest courier that you can find to carry my message. Usually, God speaks to the prophet and the prophet tells the people orally. But this time, God wanted it written down for the people to know, to see, to realize that this is what I am saying to you people. Note this, Habakkuk. But God was still gentle with him. When he reproved him, he was gentle with him. I know and understand your frustration, Habakkuk. I know that there is evil and injustice in the world. Just be patient. I will work out my plans in my own perfect time. In other words, to quote Moses as he said to the Israelites at the Red Sea in Exodus 14, 13, paraphrasing it, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Sometimes our impatience causes us to go off, make crazy choices, and do what we want to do, and then we expect God to clean up our mess. You know, I know I did wrong, Lord, but please just get me out of this time. 2 weeks later, we're in the same mess. But in this case, he wanted Habakkuk to, that's right, stand still, but he also was giving him some instructions that he would use that he could give to the people. In verses 4 and 5, we speak to the foolishness of being proud. And the Babylonians were proud and arrogant people. And we also look at the role of the faithful. God says to the prophet that the Babylonians are arrogant, greedy, drunk with wine, and drunk with their own power. However, a righteous person lives by his faith. We can live by our faith because we can put our trust in God, that he will also be faithful to his promises. We know that he will do just what he said he would do. We have seen it in our own lives that God is no shorter than his word, that what he said he will do for us, he will do. We know this is not blind faith. This is evidence. We know we have the evidence. Blind faith is you just run off and you do what you want to do and believe what you want to believe because you want to believe it. But we as believers and as Christians have evidence that God is faithful. And our God can reverse these selfish ambitions. There is hope now. There is hope because our God can reverse these selfish ambitions. He is slow to anger, and he is merciful. He is a merciful God. Just as with the prophet, God is not obligated to answer our questions. What we need and what the prophet needed was faith in God's plans, to be able to have faith in the purpose that God has purported, and what he has said he will do. And so, my brothers and sisters, our takeaway this week from this lesson is when we question God, and we will from time to time, we need to be quiet. We need to stand still. We need to listen with heart and be willing to accept the response that he gives us. Sometimes we ask God something, and when he gives us the answer, we ask him again. He gives us the same answer. We ask him again. He gives us the same answer. Because we know that at any rate, God is going to answer us. May not be what we want to hear, but it's going to be what we need. And it may not be in our time frame, but as our lesson stated, in his appointed time, in his own perfect time. So God reminded the prophet that faithfulness is most important. And God's record of faithfulness is evident to each of us this morning. And I use the term heart, and it's from our Sunday School Fellowship expositor on this past Friday night. H, hear the word. Not just with our ears, but with our whole being. E, examine the word, study, A, analyze the word. What is this word saying to me? R, remember the word. Memorize scripture. Hide it in your heart. And T, think on the word. Meditate. That's our lesson for today. And our lesson for next week begins the spring quarter, examining our faith. And the lesson is entitled, Sustaining Our Faith. And the scripture is Jude, verses 17 to 25. Let us pray. My Father and my God, we thank you for all that we've done and all that we've said this morning. We thank you, my Father and my God, for your word. We want to hide the word in our hearts that we might be able to live a faithful Christian life. Thank you, my Father, for all that you've done, all that you will do. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. We certainly thank God and honor him for the opportunity that we have to be in the household of worship one more time. We thank him for our Sunday school lesson and our Sunday school expositor for the morning, Deacon Whitehead. We realize we had just a few technical difficulties, but the Lord has brought us through it, and our videographers have worked so tirelessly to make it what it needs to be. So we are grateful to God for them and for the work that is going forward. Amen. We want to, at this time, prepare ourselves for worship. We don't know what that is. Amen. There's a lot going on today. But we want to prepare ourselves for worship and prepare our hearts for what God is going to do in our midst. Amen. 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 Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. We see our young people entering sanctuary at this time. We thank God for them. Let's give God a hand praise for our young people. Amen. We are proud of them. We're excited. We thank God for them. Most importantly, we are appreciative to their parents for being here and instead of any other place that they could be, because we could certainly find many places to be on Sunday morning, especially at a tender age. But we thank God that they're here with us today. So let us go to the Lord in prayer and begin our worship experience. Most holy, all-wise, eternal God, our Father, we thank you for the privilege that we have to be in your presence. We thank you, kind Father, for the way that you have brought us to this present moment. And we pray now, Father, that you would give us your strength and your guidance as we share. We pray, Father, that your will would be made manifest and that you would gain the glory from all that we do in this place. Help us as only you can. Bless all of those who are on the service choir, musicians, all of those who shall share, that all things might go well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We're in the hands of our young people's choir at this time.
Oh!
Amen. Now, young people have taken us down a road in terms of Black history. Amen. They've given us a medley that have reminded us of songs that we have known and sung and have been a part of our heritage and history down through the years. And so we certainly thank God for the way that He has given them the voice and the mind to do that. Can we give God praise for our young people one more time? Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. And we are going to sing for the last time this month our National Negro Anthem, hymn number 477. As I have said every Sunday in the month, if we are not proud of it, who will be? If we do not sing it with gusto, who will? If we do not hold on to it, who will? We must make this a part of who we are. We've sang it every Sunday this month. We have missed a Sunday. So this Sunday, we're going to let it ring out. Amen? Let us stand and let's sing together all three verses. Lift every voice and sing hymn number 477. Lift every voice and sing hymn number 477 in your maroon hymnals. Amen? has spoken to us as a people down through the years. This song was actually written for a assembly at a school. Principal and his brother worked together to come up with the words and the melody of the song. And we thank God that today it stands as a testimony and a testament to us in this work as we have celebrated Black History Month. We are reminded that we are Black every moment, every day. We are Black. We are Black history every day. Amen. Amen. But during the month of February, as it is with any anniversary, anything that you are part of, you turn up a little bit. Amen. When you have your birthday, you turn up. I mean, you're that same age the rest of the year, but on your birthday, you turn up. And so during the month of February, we just turn up just a bit, amen, to remind ourselves of our rich heritage and all the work. We get lit. Ain't that what the young folks say? We get lit. We get lit at Purity and other places to let them know that we are proud of who we are. Young, gifted, and Black. That's a fact, amen. And the other song says, I'm Black and I'm proud. Say it loud. I'm Black and I'm proud. Amen. And we thank God. We thank God for how he has given us this opportunity to celebrate indeed our Blackness. We want to, at this time, allow ourselves to be led to the throne of grace by Deacon Robert Henry this morning. And then following that, we'll have our welcome address. Amen. That will come to us from Deaconess Gloria Watson, amen, chairperson of our Deaconess Ministry.
Let us pray. Oh, gracious, kind Heavenly Father, Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. It is right now, dear God, we come to say thank you.
Thank you.
Dear God, we also come to worship you.
Yeah.
We also come to praise you for your word to be praised, your Heavenly Father.
Yeah.
For just last night, dear God, you watched over us as we slumbered and slept. Then bright and early this morning,
early,
you woke us up in time, Lord. Lord, you put it in our hearts and minds to come to this branch of Zion one more time. Lord, you're the creator. You're the foundation of the world. Everything that is, God, you created it. And dear God, we give you thanks. We give you praise. We worship you, dear God. Lord, right now we pray for this waiting congregation, dear God.
Yes.
We come to acknowledge you, dear God. For God, you're the author and finisher of our faith. So right now, dear God, we ask for your forgiveness, Lord. Lord, we haven't done all you assigned our hearts, hands, and minds to do. But we're so grateful that you're kind, God. Dear God, you loved us so much that you gave your son, who came down 40 and two generations, hung on that old cross of Calvary, bled and died for our sins. Dear God, we say thank you. Dear God, we pray for the word of the day, dear God. But most of all, we pray for the vehicle that you gave us today, Lord. Build up the path of the Lord on every weak and needy side, Lord, as he comes and breaks the bread of life, Lord. For in your word it says we're saved by the foolishness of preaching. Lord, and we need to preach word. Right now, God, we pray for that man, that woman, that boy or girl who know nothing at all about your saving grace. Nothing at all that you die, they may have a right to the tree of life. Lord, you are the hope of the world. We can do nothing without you, dear God. Dear God, we are so grateful for your grace. Your grace, dear God. But not only did you give us grace, but you also gave us mercy. Lord, right now we pray for those on their beds of affliction, dear God. You know what they stand in the need of. But the word says there's power in the name of Jesus. So if it be your will, Lord, touch them. We also pray for those that are bereaved, Lord. You know what they stand in the need of. But in your word it says weeping may endure for a night, but unspeakable joy cometh in the morning. So wrap us up, dear God. Stir us up. For the world needs us, Lord. They need to see that shining light that is you within us, Lord. So when we leave these four walls, dear God, give us your word. Give us your direction. But most of all, give us your love. Be with us, Lord. And Lord, right now we pray for those that are on Capitol Hill, Lord. We pray, Lord, that your word says lean not to your own understanding. And that seems to be a lot of problems, Lord. They're not leaning on you, but on themselves, Lord. But give us hope, give us direction, and give us purpose. All these blessings, dear God, we ask in thy son Jesus' name. And our soul says amen.
Amen. Visitors, please stand up. Yay!
welcome you this morning. Purity is a place for caring. Purity is a place for sharing. We are so glad that you're here with us this morning. Please enjoy yourself with this little church in the middle of the block on Capitol Hill at 1325 Merlin Avenue. Thank you all so much for coming.
Amen. We are so grateful for our powerful prayer this morning, our wonderful welcome of our visitors and guests, and we are just grateful to see. As looks like Deacon Weaver has filled up the church today, amen. She took Phil a pew seriously this morning, amen. And we are so delighted and glad about that. We know this is birthday time and all of that, and so we are just grateful. I know her heart has to be overflowing to see all of you, and I don't know that she's turned around and see those who have come in later, amen. But you've got about three or four rows back there, amen. So you know you've got it going, amen. But we are grateful to God. We are grateful to God for the presence of all of our visitors and guests, those who are here with us. And it looks like I see the girl's grandparent, other grandmother, is that right? Do I see? Yes, all right, good, all right, so that's good. We're glad. All right. So we want to continue to move on with our worship experience this morning. I am grateful for the way that our young people are sharing with us these songs that are so important to our history. I mean, they are really just pulling up songs that really just bring our hearts and minds to a place where we are thinking about what it has meant over time for us. And really, music is one of the ways that we bridge the generational gap. Music helps us to come together and to share together. And so I'm grateful that it is our young people's choir. The scripture reminds us that a child shall lead them. It is our young people's choir that has taken us on this tour, and we are grateful. We're grateful to God for that. We want to have our morning announcements now with our church clerk, Mrs. Wanda P. Freeman, and then we'll move forward with the service.
Good morning, church. It's tax time, and we are reminding our members, if you have not gotten your 2023 statements, you should do that today, maybe. If you can't get them today, we ask that you call the church and ask for them to be mailed to you, or you may come by and pick them up. The Mount Bethel Baptist Educational Congress invites you to its 70th annual session, March 11 through 15, from 6:30 p.m. until 9 p.m. 9 classes will be held in person at First Baptist Church of Highland Park, Highland Park, Maryland, and 3 classes virtually via Zoom. A flyer with the sessions are on our Purity Alert. If you are interested in attending a session, please send Sister Dabney your name and the session you would like to attend. If there are enough people enrolled, the church can register everyone as a group, and you don't have to register individually. Therefore, the sooner you send Sister Dabney your name, the better we can determine if we have enough to register as a group. Following my announcements, Deacon Motor will come to you with a reminder. Combined choir rehearsal immediately following this service. We are serving on the first Sunday in March. That's Communion Sunday, and it's also the first Sunday of our church's anniversary. We did not get a chance to put one of our little angels' names on our birthday list, so we're wishing a happy birthday to Angelique Christina Stark Stewart today. She is turning 2 years old, so I wish her a happy birthday. Sister LaShawn Clark is requesting prayer for her son, Rashawn. Rashawn is sick with the virus and has been out of school for a bit. Sister Ernestine Gilchrist is located at Serenity Rehabilitation and Health Center, 1380 Southern Avenue Southeast, room 1198, Washington, D.C. There's no phone in her room at this time. Sister Gilchrist will be in rehab for a few weeks, and then prayerfully she will be going home. Mr. Frank Moses, father of Deaconess Kimberly Moses, had surgery on Monday. He is now at home doing well. Our condolences to Deacon Paulette Grayson and the loss of her aunt, Mrs. Thelma Grayson. The services will be held on March 6, 2024 at the First Baptist Church of Merrifield, 8122 Ransel Road in Falls Church, Virginia. Visitations 10 a.m. until 11, and services will begin at 11. We ask that we remember Brother Alexander McDuffie in our prayers. He's in rehab. Our known sick and shut-in members are Deaconess Angeline Bethay, Sister Fanny Nemmons, Deaconess Elizabeth Sims, Brother Kenneth Tucker, and Deaconess Nellie Vail. We ask that you remember them in your prayers. Visit if you can. Call if they can receive calls. Send a card. Let them know that we love them and have not forgotten them. And we're going to end this morning on a congratulatory note. We congratulate Deaconess Elissa Warner Jones on her retirement a couple of months ago. She gave me permission to announce it today. And also, I forgot, Sister Moselle Logan Medcalf went to rehab on yesterday, and we continue to pray for her recovery.
Good morning, Purity.
Good morning.
Good morning. I want to thank Ms. Wanda, Pastor, and all y'all for this opportunity for a little reminder. It's a wonderful day. I'm glad to be in the house of the Lord. All the children, please stay. I want to start with, what do you see? Yes. Young people, children. Now, if we look forward, I would love to say, I'm seeing ushers, deacons, ministers, deaconess, kitchen ministry. Yes, it's just looking beyond. Now, if we go in the Bible, in chapter 19, verse 14, Jesus said, "Let the children come to me, and do not hide them, for such is the kingdom of heaven belong to such." This. Now, if we go another book forward, touching Luke, chapter 18 verse 16, you are able to see that it says the same thing. It's just a reminder that he giving us to let the children come to me. That don't mean like come to the church and drop the children. Now, Because we know it takes a village to raise a child. Because I know my neighbors back in the time. I know everybody in my congregation back in time. But because it was a little touch of each one of them. It takes a village to raise a child. But it takes a congregation to lead them in the right path. To keep them in the connection with God. Later on, they're going to college. And some, they're coming back and stay in church. Others lost that little touch, that little connection. That's what I ask for prayer. They know they are not only children choir, dance ministry, and my ministry. They are our next generation to follow. So, taking that little touch, I want to announce we know Bible class is coming for the children. So, mom, dad, uncle, grandma, grandpa, I need your help. Bring in the children to join us. Let them keep them with that connection with God, because it's needed. And it's needed on those children. I know back in time I have a lot of distraction, but the distraction today is stronger. And how we see children are raising children, but we need a little touch and the help of God. And we need a strong congregation to keep them. Also, starting every third Sunday, we are starting that, Also, we are starting bringing back the junior usher. All children 7 years old up are able to join. Even 5 years old, we got to keep them and to start training them to be at the door saying welcome. The first junior usher start serving in the service will be on April. The third Sunday on April. Rehearsal will be announced later for the children to have some practice. So it's just to grow, to teach them. It just, how I say, it takes a congregation to lead in the right path, and it takes a strong congregation to keep that flame in them and that. To keep them connected with Jesus.
Amen. I don't think any other thing that we say today will be as important or as influential as what has been said by Deacon Moda this morning. Amen. Can we give God praise for that announcement? Amen. I want to, in some way, bring some life to what he has. Well, he's already his life in it, but I want to give you four asks that Alex is asking for, Deacon Mota is asking for, as it relates to our young people being all that God would have them to be and for our responsibility to train them. The first thing he's asking for is your prayers. We need to pray for our young people. We need to pray for ourselves that we are role models and examples for them. We need to pray that with so much going on around them that they are protected and that they make strong and wise decisions about their lives. The next thing he's asking for is presence. He wants them here. He wants you here with them. We see that as the work of our church and as the work of what we're doing. And so I think that in terms of presence, making sure they are for all the things that are being created, the youth Bible study, the junior ushers, all the things that are germane to the young people, we want to be sure that they're present for them. And we don't want to relegate them or make them feel like what they do is less than what we do. So one of the reasons why even at Deacon Motor's age, why we didn't have him as a deacon auxiliary or a junior deacon or something like that, but he's a deacon, ordained like every other deacon in this church, amen? And brings his own level of wisdom, his own level of doing, and that we don't want to hinder because of age anybody that may bring something to the congregation that is beneficial, and more than that, has to serve the Lord just like we do. The scripture indicates that we all have to work out our soul salvation with fear and trembling. That's old and young. Amen. And so we've got that, and we need more people to take on that responsibility and that work. Next thing is participation. We need persons who will volunteer. Just as we look at this, this burden has been laid on Deacon Motor's heart. That's one of the reasons why we wanted him to be a deacon, because it's a burden for the young people in that. And over time, we have had different iterations of those who lead, and this is his season to do it with the help of others. But all of us work together to make this happen. Deacon Mota can get them together, he can do that, but there needs to be a person who can teach them, a person who's creative in that. I don't even know that I would be the best at it, because the way I was trained to teach is different from the way they learn these days. I've often told you the story, when I started teaching the first week of school, I would have them just sit quietly at times, just sit quietly at your, they don't talk. You're not doing it, they just sit quietly, because they need to know how to sit quietly and not just be disruptive while I'm working with groups and all that. But these days, that's not, everybody's working, everybody's up, they on computer. If they ain't got nothing, they jump in there, you gotta give them. And see, I couldn't deal with that. So make me nervous even thinking about it. I don't think I could take it, I'm telling you, I can't do that. And but so we want to have somebodies that are willing to volunteer. And it's not every Sunday, it's not every week, it's not every day. But if you're willing to come in and do it, help Alex to get it done. Let's make that work, even with our junior ushers and the other groups that are starting. And the final thing, he didn't say it, but I'm going to say it. He needs you. What's in your pocket? Amen. You might as well say amen. Because you can't do any of this unless you got some money to do it. Huh? Now, it costs to do, ministry costs money. Ministry costs money. And so he's got to have materials and all these things. Whoever teaches them, whoever works with them, they've got to have the right resources. They've got to have the stuff to take them on whatever they need to take them on trips and all that. Whatever they might need, they got to have it. They may want to serve them breakfast on the days that they work together. That costs money. And it takes somebody to get it together, warm it up, get it cooked, whatever, make sure that it's the way it needs to be. Look at all their allergies and see what's going on. So it takes money. And so we want to be mindful of those things that we're giving. As you plan to give today, if you desire to give to this work or to the work that is ahead of us so that we'll have it. We need it today, but we need those that will think about it recurring. You know, you do it today, but also next month is still gonna need, the month after that. As long as we got these young people standing before us, what did Alex say? These are our next ministers, our next deacons, our next deaconess, our next trustees, our next choir members. This is what's in this choir stand right now, if we will pour into them. If we will be responsible, we've got the next congregation, at least the nucleus of it, right here. But we've got to make sure we do it. If you want to give today, Trustee Garner, do I have anything on text to give that could remotely be used for this? What title might I use? Is youth ministry on there, something like that? All right, so we'll use youth ministry. If you want a text to give that, you can use youth ministry. If you want to just give it, Deacon Weaver, your group is getting larger. So I want you to look back and see. Your group is getting larger. All right. If we've got youth ministry on that, If you want to give by envelope, you can just write YM. Write YM on your envelope, and you can give at that time when it's time to give. Amen. But we want our young people to know that they're supported and that God is blessing. We're going to, if I can ask the congregation, all of us who are adults, to stand up and point our right arm toward our young people up in this choir stand. Because we're going to pray. We're going to pray for them, pray over them. And we're going to trust God that he will have his way in and through them. Amen. Amen. Bless the name of the Lord. We're going to pray, and we're going to trust God for them. We're going to trust God for them. They look so wonderful. They look so wonderful. And we're going to pray. Most holy, all wise, eternal God, our Father, our maker, our creator, sustainer, and our keeper, it's once again that we bow before you with humble thanksgiving and praise, O God. We thank you, Father, for the opportunity that we have to be in your presence. But most importantly, we thank you for the young people that you have sent to be a part of who we are. Right now, Father, we lift them before you, God, and we pray that you would build a hedge of protection around them, God. We pray that you would protect their hearts, their minds, their thoughts, their eye gates, their ear gates. All that shall enter, oh God, would be pleasing in your sight, Father God, and would be something that would help them to grow and be wise and make wise decisions over their life, oh God. We bind the hand of Satan right now, oh God. Any trap, any plan, anything that he has set to try to destroy them, we bind it in the name of Jesus, oh God. And we loose the free flowing of your power over their life, Father God. We pray that you would allow them to be able to step into successful things, oh God, and to do things in the way that you would have for them to do, oh God, that they would find success however they define it for themselves, oh God, that we wouldn't force them into a path, oh God, but that the path that they take would be one that is pleasing in your sight, God. Open every door and make every way, oh God. Allow them, oh God, to be able to matriculate through school and all the things that they need to do, oh God, in a way, oh God, that allows them to have the opportunities that they need, oh God. Remind them, oh God, give them the wisdom to know of the importance of the decisions that they make now on their adulthood. God, we pray for the parents, we pray for the guardians, we pray for the grandparents, we pray for the aunts, we pray for the uncles, we pray for the cousins, we pray for the extended family, all of those who shall give care. God, you give us good godly wisdom so that we can be good godly examples. And God, help us not to try to pretend like we are so perfect that we never made mistakes and make them feel like they can't make mistakes, God. But help us to keep it 100, oh God. Help us to keep it real with them, oh God, to know that we've heard some no's and we made some bad choices and we made some wrong turns. But God, you brought us through anyhow. God, we pray for those who shall lead this ministry. We pray for Deacon Mota and all of those who shall come. There are hearts in here today, God, that we pray that you would prick, oh God. They may not be able to do it every week or every Sunday, God, but prick their heart that they may even give once a month or twice a month the time to make sure that our young people are encouraged and strengthened and taught and led and guided and given good godly counsel and wisdom. God, help us as we strive to do your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Can we give God a hand clap of praise? Amen. 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 We want to, at this time, go into our moments in Black history, and we'll move forward in that way.
Role model honoring Ann Cole Love. Ms. Ann Coles Love was the first African American to become a noted fashion designer. She was best known for designing the iconic ivory silk taffeta wedding dress worn by Jacqueline Bouvier when she married John F. Kennedy. Okay, is this better?
Yes.
So I'm gonna start again. Ms. Ann Coles Love was the first African American to become a noted fashion designer. She was best known for designing the iconic ivory silk taffeta wedding dress worn by Jacqueline Bouvier when she married John F. Kennedy. Ms. Love was born December the 14th, 1898 in Clayton, Alabama to Jane and Jack Love. Ann's interest in fashion, sewing, and designing came from her mother and grandmother, both of whom were seamstresses and ran a dressmaking business. Ann's mother died when Ann was 16 and then took over the family business. She enrolled at S.T. Taylor Design School in New York City. The school was segregated. Lowe was required to attend classes in a room alone. Segregation did not stop her. Her work was recognized for her outstanding artistry, and she became eligible for graduation after only half a year. After graduating, she opened her first dress salon, which quickly became a success in Tampa, Florida. Having saved $20,000, Lowe returned to New York City and worked on commission for many high-end stores such as iMagnon, Neiman Marcus, and Saks Fifth Avenue. In 1946, she designed the dress that Olivia de Havilland wore to accept the Academy Award for Best Actress. The dress did not carry her name. Lowe opened a second salon on Lexington Avenue in 1950. Her one-of-a-kind designs made from the finest fabrics were an immediate success. Lowe created designs for several generations of the Auchincloss, Rockefeller, Post, and Bouvier families, as well as for many notable black clients. Janet Lee Bouvier chose Ms. Lowe to design her wedding dress for her marriage to Hugh D. Auchincloss in 1942. In 1947, Mrs. Auchincloss commissioned Lowe to create debutante gowns for her daughters, Jacqueline and Lee Bouvier. She again hired Lowe to design a wedding dress for her daughter, the future First Lady, Jacqueline Bouvier, for her wedding to then Senator John F. Kennedy on September the 12th, 1953. During the creation of this infamous dress, Lowe's studio flooded just 10 days before the wedding. She and her team worked tirelessly to recreate the dress at her own expense. Lowe never mentioned this incident to the family. While the Bouvier-Kennedy wedding was a highly publicized event, Lowe did not receive public credit for her work until after the assassination of President Kennedy. In 1961, she received the Courtier of the Year Award. A member of St. Mark's United Methodist Church in Harlem, she retired in 1972. Ann Lowe Cole died on February the 25th, 1981, at the age of 82, after an extended illness. Three of Ms. Lowe's designs are on display at the Smithsonian Institution's National Museum of African American History and Culture here in Washington, D.C. Ann Coles Love was the first African American to become a noted fashion designer. We have a person right here in Purity who is a seamstress and has made and created clothes. We have selected one of them to honor today. Our honoree's favorite color is olive green. Her favorite TV shows are QVC, HSN, the Hallmark Channel, Westerns, Joyce Meyer, and Charles Stanley. She enjoys most foods, but she does not like mushrooms. Her hobbies include sewing and crafts. She enjoys shopping and a spa day, mani-pedi, facial, massage, the works. She loves to spend quality time with her personal family and friends, her Purity family, and she loves to travel. Our honoree is naturally artistic and creative. She made a lot of her children's clothes. As a young adult, she was a member of a social club called Psychedelic Ladies. She made many of the outfits for her social club members. Her work career included working as a resident manager for Public Housing, National Capital Housing Authority, at various properties. She retired from this position in 1995. She went back to work as a resident manager for NCBA Estates at the Department of Housing and her Urban Development to stay close to her mom. She retired again in 2015. Our honoree joined Purity in July of 1984. She is a dedicated deacon and has been a member of the Usher's ministry for many years. Before becoming a deacon, she served on the trustee board and now serves as the leader of the trustee ministry. She serves in the office once a week, and she is instrumental in keeping our bulletin boards current and looking nice. She is also a member of the Academic Recognition Committee. Ms. Emma Watts Willis, her mother-in-law from her first marriage, was instrumental in introducing and leading her to Christ. She was like a daughter to Ms. Emma Willis, as she had five boys and no girls. Our honoree was born in Washington, D.C. on February the 25th to Ms. Beatrice Kelly Hammond and Mr. Frank Ferguson. As a child, she lived in New York for a while with her Aunt Rebecca, Aunt Ethel, Aunt Nancy, and Cousin Gloria. She attended Terrell Junior High School and Spingarn High School Night School. Our honoree has four siblings, Lorraine, Cheryl, Robert, and Edward, and five children, Charlene, Patricia, Selena, Eugene, and Rashad. She has 15 grandchildren. Angel, Danae, Jasmine, Valerie, Delonte, Brittany, Jasmine, Melvin, Melanie, Lewis, Kai, Christian, Cameron, Embry, Monroe, and Chase. And she has 12 great-grandchildren, Kayla, Jayla, Kaya, Zuri, Quentin, Christopher, Braden, Ezra, Jacqueline, Camille, Ariel, and Amora. Our honoree married Tyrone Weaver, November the 17th, 1996. Our honoree's family shares that, as a young mother, she made sure that all her children were well taken care of. She has the instinctive ability and gentleness to mentor and provide a word for those in need. She can reach any age group from all walks of life. She is excellent at imparting her wisdom where it is well received. It comes from a gentle place. She has a nurturing nature. She sees the good in people, looks for the good in people. She's a giver, one of those people who always has something to give when she sees you or visits. She gives good and honest feedback and love. In the area of event planning, she is a natural in staging and executing creative ideas. Our honoree is known for some sayings. For example, when talking out loud to God, she will often say, "Thank you for my time." A saying she got from her mother, "It's just good to get out." Other expressions that her family state she often says, "Give it to God. This too shall pass. All is well, it is well." And when praising God, "Hallelujah," with her hands to the sky, "Thank you, Jesus." As we celebrate our 2024 Purity Moments in Black History, we recognize and celebrate our members who are role models sitting right here among us. We present to you Deacon Patricia Ferguson Willis Weaver, a Purity role model.
Amen, amen. I'm in trouble. Y'all not in trouble. I'm in trouble. Amen. Amen. Good trouble, though. Amen. Amen. We are delighted to have this opportunity. We have wanted it for some time, and finally all things came together. And we are delighted to have this opportunity today to honor you, Deacon Weaver, in this way as a role model here in our congregation. We have done this many times, and I say to all of the persons, we look up to you. We look up to you in many ways for many things. Somebody talked about the sayings that she says. There's some that I repeat even myself that she says that weren't listed there. But I want to read your certificate, present it, and thank you. And listen, you have filled. You see all the folks. That's a blessing. That's a blessing. 2024 Moments in Black History Role Model Award presented to Deacon Patricia Ferguson Willis Weaver here at the Purity Baptist Church and Urban Center on February 25th, 2024, signed by the pastor. This is your award, and this is your gift. Amen.
Thank you. This is the best birthday present ever. With all of my people, my loved ones, my Purity family, my little people. Thank you, Jesus. It's the best gift I could ever have. Some things money cannot buy. And when people give you their time and their attention, that's the best gift that they can give you. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Pastor.
Amen. Amen. What a joy. 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 Amen. 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 We want to, amen. We want to, at this time, prepare our hearts and minds for our offertory period. I said earlier while up in the pulpit that we want to remember our youth ministry and the work that they're doing, and everything that we need to finance that it's right in the house, it's just in your wallet, and we got to get it in the church bank account. Amen. So we want to we want you to remember that. If you want to give electronically, you can text the message PBCUC to the digit 73256, select youth ministry or whatever ministry you would like to give toward, and you can give that way. And remember, it'll recur over time. If you want to give when the ushers come, you can give as they pass at the appropriate time. But however you give, give as the Lord has prospered you. And we do want to be reminded that much has gone on last week. We thank God for the opportunity we've had to celebrate two of our members, and now three, in their birthdays this week. And what a beautiful time we had in both places. Amen. And I see Deaconess Johnson sitting on the edge of her seat. Amen. She turned 90. Amen. And we're grateful for that. Amen. Amen. And then, of course, we celebrated, it's upcoming, we celebrated with Deacon Minnick on yesterday. She turned 85. Amen. 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 We're gonna go back. We haven't done it in a couple of years, but we're going to go back to calling those birthday names during the announcement period. We haven't done that. We gotten away from it, and I understand why, because it's, you know, it takes time, and we were in a pandemic and all that was happening, and people really weren't here. But it gives us the opportunity to have a little moment. Ain't nobody tell you you talking today. You just standing there. Ain't you something? That's what 90 would do. Come on, come on. Make your way up here. Come on, make your way up here, Wilder. Come on. Come on. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. I'm telling you, she want to show them shimmeries off. Amen. Look at her. Look at her. Look at her. She's showing off. Come on. Come on and talk. Come on and talk.
I have to get up here. Pat, I know what you mean. Last Sunday was the best birthday I've ever had. And I'm just so thankful for each one of you who sent me cards. Gave me cards when I came in church, mailed me cards. It was so beautiful. The place was full with my family. Nobody else could get in there, and all of them wasn't there. Still had some children, grandchildren missing. But I just want you to know that I really enjoyed myself. I enjoyed seeing you, some of the Puritans. I wish I could have invited everybody in here, but you know how that goes. But I just want to stand here today and let you know how thankful I am. Thankful to God who has blessed me to see 90 years. Still walking, still talking, still yes. Driving, sneaking. The kids don't want me to drive. I sneak off with the keys. They're threatening to take my keys, but I don't know. You can't take my keys because I might want to do something and you're not there to take me. So again, thank you all so much. And may God continue to bless each one of you to see 9 years.
Amen. Amen. Wonderful. Wonderful. Amen. Ain't she glittered down today? Showing off, I'm telling you. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. We are so grateful for all of our members, but back to that, we want to allow that opportunity for our members to hear their names called. Sometimes what will happen when we do that, sometimes, you know, the list might be missing a name or something like that. And I'm going to ask you right now, if we go back to that, I'm going to ask you right now to be patient in times like that. We don't intentionally, I know somebody will try to put it in your mind, but nobody will intentionally leave your name off the list, amen? That's just not who we are as a church. But if it gets left off, all you've got to do, you can, the easiest thing to do is respectfully and calmly, while the list is being listed, to just simply stand and let us know that your name should also be included, and we will do it that way. If not, then you will certainly talk to the clerk after, and we'll make sure that it is acknowledged on the next Sunday. The list comes out by email, so you'll know who's on the list, and you'll see ahead of time whether your name is there. But we want to give that moment. And I think those moments make a difference. And in a congregation where we are continuing to strive to be all that God would have us to be, we all need those moments every now and then. I think Deacon Weaver said it best, when we give people our time and attention, that is one of the best gifts that we can give. All right, so we're ready. For our offertory period at this time, we want to look to the Lord in prayer. We need the tithe box too. Amen. We want to be ready to receive our tithes at the appropriate time, and then we will move forward in the service of the Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Most holy, all-wise, eternal God, our Father, we thank you for the privilege that we have to be in your presence. God, we need you. We need you to be with us as we give. And we pray that what is given be used for the upbuilding of your kingdom and the furtherance of the ministries of Purity Baptist Church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tithers, will you come? And if you tithe electronically, you just come up and tap the box, and that's still a blessing to us. Amen.
Let it shine. Let it shine.
Thank God. We thank you for your gifts. We heard about the retirement of Sister Deaconess Darlene Warner Jones. We want to announce the coming retirement. It's on Tuesday. The retirement of Trustee Gloria Henry after 38 years of service. Amen. We give God praise. Amen. Getting a new crop of retirees at Purity, amen. And we thank God for those persons who have worked and who have done what's necessary to be done. I had the opportunity to talk with both of them, actually, but on yesterday with Trustee Henry about retirement and all that she has planned to do. And we know that God is going to bless her and her family, even through all that she has accomplished in those 38 years. And many of us, or many of you, when you reach that, the point of retirement, you think back on how far God brought you, where you never knew you would even achieve the things that you achieved, and yet God is good. And so we congratulate Deaconess Warner Jones, we congratulate Trustee Henry, and we're looking forward to all that God is going to do. Amen? Amen. This Sunday is actually the church anniversary. We will celebrate it in March. We celebrate our anniversary month in March. But we were actually born on the fourth Sunday in February. And we decided that we would celebrate March because we have always believed strongly in Black history. And so we were not going to take anything away from the celebration of Black History Month, which is why we celebrate our anniversary in March. So happy 77th birthday, Purity, on today, amen. Amen. We are 77 years old, and we look good for our age, amen. And we're doing well for what God has blessed us to do. And so we have the month of March coming before us. We've got some guest preachers, Reverend Alfred Wright, St. Philip's Baptist Church, Dr. Saritha Pearsall, and others who will come and bless us during the month of March. We know March this year includes our, includes Easter, and then what comes before Easter, Palm Sunday. Now I know some of you all are much more spiritual than me. You call it Resurrection Sunday, but you were calling it Easter before you knew it was Resurrection Sunday. And so Easter and Palm Sunday, amen, that's what you were called. You ain't know nothing about no Resurrection Sunday, so you just found that out, amen. So if I say Easter, then that's what I mean, amen. And so we want to celebrate those, and so that means we'll have guests the first three Sundays, but the last two. We will not. But we're looking forward to what God is doing on the fourth Sunday, which will be Palm Sunday. We'll wear our yellow and white to display our church colors. Amen? Amen. Amen. At this time, we want to hear from our choir and our mime ministry. Amen. In the reverse, our mime ministry. Oh, they all together. Okay. Well, y'all do it together. Come on, let's make it happen. Amen.
Hey! to be young, gifted and black. Open your heart to what I mean. In the whole world, you know, there are billion boys and girls who are young, gifted and black.
And that's a
we are young, gifted, and black. We must begin to tell our young. There's a world waiting for you. This is a quest that just begun. When you there's a great truth you should know. When you are young, gifted and black, your soul's intact. When you are young, gifted and black, I long to know the truth.
God for all that has happened, continues to happen in our midst today. Truly God is great and he is greatly to be praised. Amen. Amen. They have done a wonderful job today. Can we give Sister Dabney a hand of praise? She has orchestrated our moments in Black history as she does every year, and so we appreciate that. Amen. Amen. Let's give God praise. God. To again be reminded that we are celebrating our 77th church anniversary, amen. And one of the things that Pastor Wingate instilled in me, having been trained by him, was the understanding that no one needs to come in and share the theme or the theme scripture with your congregation if you haven't done so yourself. You are the pastor, and God is the visionary, giving you the vision, and you ought to share the theme. And so we're going to work through this theme scripture today. We will probably hear it at other times in the month of March, and we are fine with that. But we are going to work through it today, and I think it fits us well. I think what happened today certainly gives us, or gives confirmation to what God is doing in our midst. Our theme for this 77th year will be empowered by faith, impacting the generations. Empowered by faith, impacting the generations. And our theme scripture, which is our scripture for the morning, so you can stand as we read it together, Psalm 145, verses 3 through 10. Psalm 145, verses 3 through 10. Actually, we'll start at the first verse. I will extol thee, my God, O King, and I will bless thy name forever and ever. Every day will I bless thee, and I will praise thy name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise thy works to another, and shall declare thy mighty acts. I will speak of the glorious honor of thy majesty and of thy wondrous works. And men shall speak of the might of thy terrible acts, and I will declare thy greatness. They shall abundantly utter the memory of thy greatness and shall sing of thy righteousness. The Lord is gracious, full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great mercy. The Lord is good to all. His tender mercies are over all his works. All thy works shall praise thee, O Lord, and thy saints shall bless thee. Verse 4 again, one generation shall praise thy works to another and shall declare thy mighty acts. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Our theme again, empowered by faith, impacting the generations. Let us pray. Most holy, all-wise, eternal God, our Father, we need to hear from you. We need a word from you. If we don't hear from you, what will we do? Discretion is now with you. Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, you are my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you, ushers. We find ourselves this morning at a very pivotal point in the life and history of our church. Today we have seen the honoring of those who are integral in our work and ministry. We have seen the understanding of persons who are moving forward, have worked careers and have done that and are now moving to a different stage in life. We've heard a great appeal from one of our youngest deacons about the young people in our congregation, where we want to restart and rebuild a work that has been laid on our hearts down through the years. And then we realized this is our 77th birthday. And with all of those things that color the tapestry of the day, we are reminded that God has a work for us to do that is beyond where we sit today. He has a work for us to do that encounters not just who we are right now, and not without with understanding who we have been, but it also embraces who we are becoming. For in the midst of where we have been and where we are presently, there is still the understanding that we are still becoming. We are always in the posture and the stance of becoming. Even right now, while you're sitting in your presence, in your present moment, there are some things that you are becoming. God has a way of transforming us even in our present moment so that our next moments won't be the same as our present moments. For many of us, we get a little nervous about that, but it really ought to bring us joy because it ought to remind us that no matter where we are now, that God has greater for us. There is something new, a new avenue, a new door, a new way, a new possibility that he has for us. And for many of us who are part of this congregation based on either our own physical age or the age of the church, we may feel like we have reached our pinnacle. There were those who served in the Hockett administration and they thought they had reached their pinnacle. Those who served in the Wingate administration and thought they had reached their pinnacle. Those who served in the Johnson administration who thought the same. Those who served under Dr. Mangrum who thought the same. And then we have this, the Toogood administration, and there are some who will think we'll go no higher. But let me tell you, there'll be administrations beyond Toogood. If the Lord shall tarry. And in every time we have a present thing going, God is still creating something new in us. And so we cannot say because we have come to this present moment and we thank God for all the things that he has done for us. But we cannot say because we are in this moment that we have somehow reached our pinnacle and there's nothing more for us to do. May I remind you that the reason that you opened your eyes this morning, the reason that you are still wrapped in your right mind, that you are able to turn on the electricity, to use the water, to dress yourself, to arrive at church however you got here, the reason that you had the activity of your limbs and the ability to do is because God still has some use for you in this world. God still has something that he wants to draw out of you, that he wants to use you to do, that he wants you to allow him to do through you. And that's why he's given you this moment. Our deacons used to pray. I don't hear it as much now, but they would pray. He allowed our golden moments. It was really Dr. Wingate that said that, allowed our golden moments to roll on just a little while longer. We cannot become so enraptured in what we have done, and even our present moment, that we lose the fight as to who we are becoming. And sometimes we allow our past, and even our present experience, to hinder the becoming. But I want to remind you that God still has worth and use for you beyond your present moment. I want to challenge our congregation today that we do not allow the excuses because we can make them to hinder us from who we are becoming. Our theme for this anniversary is Empowered by Faith. Our work is a generational work. It is a work that challenges us to look at the generations differently and to see the connectivity that we must have in order to see what we have been, who we are right now, translate into who we are becoming. I don't believe that any better example for a sermon could have been than what was announced today by Deacon Mota. Deacon Mota stood our young people up and he said to us, the positions that we think we hold right now, the things that we are holding on to, minister, deacon, deaconess, trustee, whatever we are, usher, choir member, the things that we take so seriously and that we show up on Saturdays and during the week to prepare ourselves for, that we pray about, that we have had services to set us apart for. He said that those things, if we want them to continue, if we want that work to continue, it may not be us that does, but if we want to see another trustee and another deacon and another pastor and another usher and another nurse and another person, if we want to see the work continue beyond us, then in the greatest illustration ever, he stood the young people up and we looked at them and we saw them. It almost seems cliche, but the truth of the matter is the children are our future. And we truly have to teach them well and then let them lead the way. We must be careful to show them all of the beauty that they possess inside. That means that it takes some sacrifice on our hand. Make sure that we are first empowered by our faith. Psalmist David gave his own testimony. He said, I will extol thee, my God, O King. I will bless your name forever. Every day will I bless thee, and I will praise thy name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. David understood that in his declaration, in his giving his testimony, that it was his faith that was leading and guiding him. It was God that had given him the vision and the mind to see, and his faith in God that caused him to know that there was something greater beyond the moment that he was standing in. David realized that his faith was going to empower him to be able to stand when obstacles come. It was his faith that was going to give him the understanding that my present reality doesn't have to be my full reality, that God can still restore, renew, rebuild, and refurbish me and make me what he would have for me to be. That I don't have to stay stuck in any shape. That God is always doing great things. As a church, we have had our ups and downs. We've had our good days, our bad days, and yet God has still kept us. Here we are, 77 years old, and our lights are still on. Our carpet is still here. Our water is still running. Our building is still here. We've got a Montessori school downstairs. We've got several ministries that are active. We are open for food distribution. Our church doors are open not just one or two days, but 7 days a week. Even during the pandemic, 5 days a week, that school was still open and people were still able to come in. During the pandemic, we still served the homeless and the food that was necessary. We still had our food pantry. We still had our clothing pantry. We had church in this sanctuary every single Sunday during the pandemic. Not because Too Good is so good, not because Minnick is all right, not because Henry is so great, but simply because God is great. And greatly to be praised. And somebody said, I'm not going to give up on his greatness by allowing my weakness to stand in the way of him being great. We were reminded of our faith, and our faith didn't just remind us, but it empowered us. I look over there, CJ sat on those drums. Sometime we would have to start service over because the thing went out. Mook, we were on dial-up. We got all this stuff now, but the cape, the Wi-Fi, the internet was just spinning. and we would have to restart the service. And they had to go through it. There are times when it wasn't no, and CJ would have to guide us just through the drums. But we all did it because our faith empowered us. And all I'm trying to tell you today is that the challenges that lie ahead of us, the challenges that have been placed before us, the challenges that have been given to us today, we have heard the appeal of our deacon related to our young people. We know the things that we have to do as a church family, our men's ministry, our women's ministry, Women's Day, Men's Day, all these things coming together. We understand that, and yet we realize that in the midst of it, we must take a stand to band together, to bind together, to do it in a way that will please God, but show our unity. And for as much as we are grateful for who we have, we must also remain open and welcoming to those who come in and out of our doors to grow with us. I've reminded our officers many times, we don't force anybody into church membership. But we always make the opportunity welcome. And we let them know that, we let anybody know that your hands are needed, your mind is needed, your heart is needed. Your heart is going to be cared for here. We remind everybody, and then I'm going to finish this sermon up, because you've got all month to hear more about it. But we remind everybody that we are not a perfect church. I want to bring that out because sometimes we think in the church that we should find. In the church. Even in the church, they're doing this. You got people that spend 45 an hour talking from person to person about what shouldn't be done in the church. As if Jesus did not already say that he came not to strengthen the righteous, but he came to call sinners to repentance. And the avenue by which he was going to do that was through the church. So that means that in the church, you're going to have, I know we dress it up nice and put on our clothes and put on our cologne and put on our big crosses and in our Bibles and everything, and we dress it up nice, we look good, but that doesn't mean, that outward appearance doesn't mean that perfection is on the inside. Give some of us 2 minutes. Get out in the parking lot and scratch the door on our car while you open yours, and you'll find out. I'm going to tell this quick story and then I'm going to let it go. Somebody hit my car. I just got that car. Somebody hit my car on the BW Parkway and then decided they were going to just keep on driving. I'm going to tell you right now, Doc, you're not going to keep on driving. I know you hit my car. You just swinging all through the lanes. Listen. I said, Lord, you're going to have to forgive me. You ever looked at yourself, went out of yourself and looked down at yourself and you said, Lord, I'm acting a fool. We on BW Parkway and I'm at least going to get this camera, this picture of this tag, at least. So finally, I guess he said, this person is not going to stop, so I'm going to have to pull over. So we pull over. You know, BW Parkway doesn't have a... crazy, and adrenaline is going on. I jump out the car. Do you know you hit my car? And then you're going to keep on driving like you didn't. I know you know. So I said, Lord, I'm reminded of what I say every Sunday, that I'm not a perfect pastor. We are not perfect. Because there
are times where things will prick us in a way that remind us that we are not perfect. But that does not in any way suggest that God cannot use us for what he needs to use us for. Because the scripture records that the gifts and the calling of God come without repentance. That means that whatever he called you to do in spite of yourself, he still gives you the gifting to be able to do it. You may fall off the wagon sometime. You may drag slow sometime. You may not cross every I, dot every T, dot every I, cross every T. But God, when he put it in you, when your faith empowers you, then you are reminded there are generations besides yourself. Sometimes in the church we get selfish. I know we don't want to admit it, but we get selfish. We only want to hear the music we want to hear. And don't sing enough anthems for me. I love the anthems. Oh, back when they used to sing anthems. They don't sing enough hymns. So, oh, I just love him. Why they got to sing all this new? Oh, the hymns of the church. Oh, God, for the hymns, Lord. All these beautiful hymn books. Oh, the spirituals, Lord. We used to have choirs that just sang spirituals, Lord. Look at us now, Lord. Oh, the new music, the new gospel. We get so selfish sometimes that we don't realize that one generation, Psalmist David said it, one generation has to praise his works to another. Well, these generations have got to speak together. You realize in this church we've got seven generations? People are worried about millennials. Millennials are not young anymore. You don't need to go to no more conferences about millennials. You didn't need to go to them when you went to them. What the millennials are going to do with the church, the same thing you did with it. We go into these conferences. I was supposed to go to a conference in Tennessee. I looked on the thing, all this stuff about, I'm not going to no conference about no millennials. Millennials are 40 years old. I'm not doing that. That's a waste of my time. We've got the greatest generation, 1901 to 1924. We've got those here in our congregation. We've got the silent generation, 1925 to 1945. Baby boomers, 46 to 64. Generation X, 65 to 80. Millennials, 81 to 96. And then we've got two generations below millennials. And that's what we need to realize. Millennials are not the young people in the church anymore. We've got Generation Z, 1997 through 2012, and then Generation Alpha, 2013 to 2025. And you having conferences about millennials. One generation. We've got to learn that God has a way for each one of us. And we must be patient enough with one another to realize that God has a way of moving each one of us through the phases of life. At some point, somebody said, these baby boomers are going to tear up the church. And somebody said, this silent generation just don't know what to do with the church. And at some point, somebody said, Gen X just going to leave the church and never come back. And yet, God has brought us all back. And if we pray long enough, God will transform every generation. But we have to come out of our selfishness. We have to come out of seeing it only our way. Some of our young people are directors, deputy directors, all this on their jobs, and they come to church, and we say, baby, you can't do more than be Sunday school secretary. They handling millions of dollars everywhere else. And we don't trust them to handle $50 here. I ain't gonna win no friends today. Y'all got three Sundays without me preaching, so you'll be able to get yourselves together by the time I come back on Palm Sunday. We've got to learn to hold one another together. And young people, we can't say to the, I don't want to hear that old stuff. I don't want to deal with it. No, because that's a part of what makes our senior generations comfortable. We got to listen. We got to work. We got to deal with it. We got to go with it every now and then. We got to sing. We got to sing hymns. We got to sing spirit. We got to sing. We got to do all of these things because we are a multi-generational work. And David has, through the word of God, helped us to understand that generations can't sit in isolation. But they must work together to bring about the success of whatever we are doing. He said, and the thing that ought to unite us ought to always be the Lord. Verse 8, he said, the Lord is gracious, full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great mercy. That helps us to realize that no matter where we fall on the spectrum, that God still loves us, that God is still on the throne, that he's still in charge, that he's still making a difference in our lives. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works. All of your works shall praise thee. We will give you all the glory. As a church, I challenge you today, whether we shout or not at the end of this message, I challenge you today to be empowered by your faith and to step out of any comfort zone that may have caused you to feel selfish in your wanting to see things done your way, to the point that you don't allow God to work through our congregation and to work through who we are as believers in Christ, to see his will be made manifest in our work. Let us never allow petty differences. Because let me tell you something. If we divide ourselves over whether we have a responsive reading or whether we sing a hymn or whether we sing Kirk Franklin or whether we sing Ty Tribbett, if we divide ourselves over that, we have lost the blessing of who we are as a family. God wants better for us. We must stand tall to do it. I reminded you last Sunday, there ought to be joy in your heart when we come into the house of the Lord. You ought to be glad. And that gladness starts within. I challenge you today to remember his goodness, to remember his mercy, to remember your faith, and to allow your faith to push you beyond your limitations. Because what faith says is where you stop, God takes over. What faith says is as far as you have gone, God can take you further. What faith says is that no matter how dark it may be, he can bring you into the light. What faith says is even in a dead situation, God is able to renew life. What faith says is even when a stone of rejection, a stone of obstacle is moved into your way, that God is able to roll the stone away. You don't believe he's a stone roller? You don't believe that he can bring new life? You don't believe that he can bring light in dark places? May I take you down Golgotha's road to a hill called Calvary? They beat our Savior all night long. They put nails in his hands. Nails in his feet. A crown of thorns on his head. And can I tell you what he did? He died. He didn't faint. He didn't swoon. But he died on Calvary's cross. But before he died, he said, Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. I'm so glad to know that Jesus showed us that when you're going into a dark place, the best thing to do is to make sure that you're in the hand of God. And when you get in the hand of God, No matter how dark the future may be, no matter how dark the night may be, God will bring you out. You don't believe he'll bring you out? He put Jesus in the tomb. He stayed there all night Friday. He stayed there all day Saturday. But just before the breaking of day, while the dew was still on the roses, early, 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 he got up with all power. If you believe he's got power, say yeah, yeah, yeah. Ain't he all right? Won't he make a way? Yeah, yeah. Maybe there is somebody today that is outside of the ark of safety, that does not know the Lord and the pardon of their sins. Somebody here in this house that has not received Jesus as their Savior. We offer Christ to you, oh my brother. We offer Christ to you, oh my sister. He will give you brand new life. New life abundantly. But you've got to come to him. Let me tell you three reasons why you need Jesus. One, because you have a past. Two, because you need a friend. Three, because he holds the future. And if today you hear his voice, scripture reminds us that we confess with our mouth, believe with our heart that Jesus Christ is Lord, that God raised him from the dead, the same shall be saved. So we're going to pray this prayer of faith, and if you're praying it for the first time, pray it with all of your heart. Trust God to do what he said he would do. Lord Jesus, I invite you into my life. I believe you died for me, and that your blood pays for my sin and provides me with the gift of eternal life. By faith, I receive that gift, and I acknowledge you as my Lord and my Savior. Amen, amen, amen. Can we give God praise for somebody that prayed that prayer for the first time? If you are here today and you prayed that prayer for the first time, you need a church home. If you are here and you're saved, you've prayed that prayer long ago, but you're saved and you're without a church home, we want to let you know that the doors of purity stand on open hinges. The doors of the church stand on open hinges. In fact, Jesus opened them 2,000 years ago, and we got a word, and 77 years ago, we opened these doors. And so we want you to be a part. I have said every Sunday, and I've even said during the sermon, we are not a perfect church. I'm not a perfect pastor. We are not a perfect people. But together we serve a God who empowers us to move beyond our weakness and to see the day better. If you're here today, whether you're online, you can type I am home. If you're in the sanctuary, you can come down. We'll receive you. We'll pray with you, and we will work together to work out our own soul salvation. With fear and with trembling. Will there be just one? Will there be just one? Will there be just one? Amen. Though none have come, yet there is still room at the cross for you. Amen. What a powerful day, powerful opportunity to serve God. Spirit and in truth. We are delighted and excited that we have turned 77. So we're going to turn up about that now all the month of March. We turned up for Black History Month in February. Now we're going to get lit for our anniversary. Amen? Amen. And we're going to have a great time celebrating the work that God has done for us in 77 years. So please join us as we share worship. We do know that Easter and Palm Sunday come during the month of March, and so we'll have those celebrations as well, and we're looking forward to all that that will bring. Do know that we will have a Monday-Thursday service, and that's Thursday the 28th of March at 12 noon. And we're looking forward to sharing in worship with you. I hope that your Lenten season is continuing to be prosperous. As I reminded you at the beginning of it, I don't give up food or anything like that. I typically give up a character flaw or something. I know you all don't have any flaws, but I have some flaws, and I give up one. And I hope that it'll stay gone. Some of them I haven't put on the table yet because I ain't ready to. I know y'all much more spiritual than me, so you don't understand that. But some things I'm still. So I don't give them up. But maybe one day the Lord would do it. But we are trusting God to have his way. Wherever you go, whatever you do, praise God. Give God your heart and give God your hand, and he'll give you the victory. He's a victory-giving God, and he'll fight your battle if you learn to keep still. God be with you. Amen.